Welcome to Live from the Grand Teton Music Festival from Jackson Hole, Wyoming. Each summer, the Grand Teton Music Festival takes place in the Teton Mountains of Wyoming. Led by Maestro Donald Runnicles, the renowned festival orchestra consists of the finest players from more than 90 orchestras around the world. I'm Jeff Counts, General Manager, and I'd like to introduce you to my friend and co-host, Music Director Donald Runnicles.
Thank you, Jeff. It's great to be here.
Great to be with you as well. Donald, we've got a big program for our audience today. Yefim Bronfman joins us for a magnificent performance of Johannes Brahms' massive first piano concerto. This piece is really more like a symphony for piano and orchestra. More on that in a minute, though. First, let's hear a little bonus from the festival's recent CD release on reference recordings of the complete Beethoven piano concertos with Garrick Olson. This is Beethoven's Overture to the Creatures of Prometheus, Opus 43. It was his one and only ballet written in 1801, and incidentally is a piece I know that you, Donald, greatly admire. This was recorded in our very own Walk Festival Hall in 2022.
Thank you.
You've just heard Beethoven's Overture to the Creatures of Prometheus, in performance at Walk Festival Hall in 2022 and part of GTMF's recent CD release on reference recordings of the complete Beethoven piano concertos.
You're listening to Live from the Grand Teton Music Festival. I'm Donald Runnicles.
And I'm Jeff Counts. Now on to Brahms Concerto No. 1, a massive concerto, as I said before. First began life as a two-piano work, and then for a while, Brahms conceived of it as a four-movement symphony. Critics at the premiere did not have kind words, though. One wrote of the second performance in Leipzig that the concerto, quote, cannot give pleasure, end quote, lamenting that it contained, again I quote, the shrillest dissonances and the most unpleasant sounds. Donald, it's hard to read something like that about a work by Brahms, but not every piece had successful premieres, did they?
No. One has to smile when one reads it can't give pleasure. Yeah. And really, are we talking about the same work that we know and love? I think this is probably, amongst Brahms' major works, probably one of the most difficult births, giving form to this work. He was a youngster, 25, 26, but this was forming in his mind for a long, long time. Of course, we know that the shadow of Ludwig van Beethoven, particularly with the Ninth Symphony, was a long shadow indeed. Any composer around that time thinking to write a symphony would have been somewhat probably intimidated. So he worked very, very hard on what originally might have been a symphony, and it did morph eventually into the piano concerto, not as we know it now. He went back to it after the first performances and made some substantial revisions. Yes, this is what great composers did. One can't conceive of it with Haydn and Mozart in some level when you just think how many works they wrote. I don't know if they went back and made revisions. They just kept going. You think of Beethoven, you think of the first and only opera, Leonora, which after performances in Vienna, he withdrew and made huge changes to it. Emerged from that was the opera we know and revere today, Fidelio. Think of Anton Bruckner. Think of how many more symphonies he might have written if he hadn't been plagued by self-doubt, by poor critical responses, audience responses, also his colleagues saying, you have to revise that Eighth Symphony. You have to revise the Fourth or the Fifth. He kept going back and fine-tuning it. Madame a Butterfly, five versions until he got to that version that we know and love today. So yes, it's not a sign of weakness. It's part of that process.
Beethoven's shadow absolutely stalks this music, the incubation period being from 1854 to 59. And in that time, he would have heard for the first time the Ninth Symphony, which I'm sure scared him to death and made him very reluctant to tackle the form himself. Also during that time was the beginning of his relationship with the Schumanns, Robert's death. I think that Beethoven's fingerprints are on this music as well as Robert and Clara's. He certainly wrote it for Clara. That story is several podcasts long between Johannes and her. I think that this music occupied a very important time during his life, and it's impossible to hear it now without thinking about all of those experiences and influences. The critical comments are one side of it. And I agree with you that every composer worth anything goes back and reconsiders the things they've done. But I think that the ingredients at the beginning are just as interesting as anything he added to it later.
Well, absolutely. And it was this long, very, very intimidating shadow thrown by Ludwig van Beethoven, which caused him to always feel this self-doubt, this feeling of, am I good enough? Can I really write the symphony that people will think is my symphony and not Beethoven's 10th symphony? And I think the fact that he waited until relatively late in his life, much like Bruckner, to finally commit to a first symphony, tells us a lot about the reverence in which he held the music of Beethoven, the music of Schumann as well. Then out of this symphony emerged this incredible piano concerto. Just in the first bars, you have the feeling that it's hewn out of granite. It's so powerful. It's so strong. It's so dramatic. And I know we've talked about this many times. We're rather wed to this image of a reclining, middle-aged composer with a very long beard and a paunch.
Yes.
Sitting at the piano, and we kind of think that this must have been Brahms, you know, from an early age. No. Look at the pictures of the young Brahms when he met Schumann, when he met Clara for the first time.
Svelte and dashing.
Ah, incredibly handsome young man. And I mean, I just mentioned that because he was very young when he started writing this music. With time emerged this phenomenal piano concerto, which does indeed have a very symphonic feel to it.
Before we listen, I can't pass up the opportunity to ask you a question about working with FEMA. We've talked about it many times on this radio program. I know that the two of you have a connection born over years of collaboration. Is this piece a special one now in your history with him?
Oh, yes, a very special one. I was a little fearful of this. I mean, I've done so many of the big works with FEMA. The first piano concerto is a very daunting work to play, but also in terms of accompanying it, not just finding these craggy peaks, but also the tenderness, the beauty of the slow movement. It's a challenging work, but it was most certainly a very typical process working with FEMA that we didn't spend a minute beforehand talking about what are we going to do. You know, FEMA's always very, very witty, and it'll be probably more along the lines of, Maestro, show me what to do. You
know, of course.
This feeling of, let's just go and do it and let's see what happens. Not hours of preparation where we're talking about transitions and this, that, and the other. And that leaves so much room. And, of course, that has a lot to do with our very close relationship. I'd like to think this performance is a testament, not just to our bond, but his bond. He loves this orchestra. The orchestra adore him. He loves being in the Grand Tetons. This gentle giant sits down, much like a Gary Colson, and just dazzles us all.
You can hear proof of that bond made manifest in sound right now as we enter Walk Festival Hall to hear this sonata, turned symphony, turned piano concerto, the Brahms First. Yefim Bronfman and Donald Runnicles take the stage together with the Grand Teton Music Festival Orchestra here in Jackson Hole, Wyoming.
Thank you. Thank you.
That was the mighty Brahms' first piano concerto. Yefim Bronfman joined Donald Runnicles with the Grand Teton Music Festival Orchestra in Walk Festival Hall in Jackson Hole, Wyoming. This has been a presentation of the Grand Teton Music Festival, located in Jackson Hole, Wyoming.
Live from the Grand Teton Music Festival is a co-production of the Grand Teton Music Festival and Classic Digital Syndications. Vic Munzer is our producer. He is also our recording engineer, along with Kevin Harbison. We would love to hear from you. Write to us. Simply send us an email to listener@gtmf.org. And by all means, come visit us in the summer in Jackson Hole. For more information about the festival, visit gtmf.org. You can also look for us on our very own recording label, Reference Recordings. I'm Donald Runnicles.
And I'm Jeff Counts. Thank you so much for listening.
Thank you.